Judge, first of all, thank you for doing this. This is for the Southern District of Iowa branch of the Historical Society for U.S. Courts in the Eighth Circuit. It will be, copies will be sent to libraries everywhere in the world from Emmitsburg down. You're very kind to, you're very kind to do this. A long line of distinguished judges have done this before you. Let's start at the beginning. Emmitsburg.
Yeah.
Born in May 3rd of 1947. Tell me about your dad and your mom, especially your mom.
Okay. Well, I was born 2 weeks after Jackie Robinson broke into organized baseball at the major league level. And I was in the middle. My parents were older. My mother was born in 1910. My dad was born in 1903. My father was one of eight children. And my mother was the glue that held our family together. My mother did things before women generally did things. She went to college and graduated in 1935 or 36. There's some discrepancy about which year.
From Iowa State.
She had begun, she was a native of Rockford, rural Rockford, Iowa, which is Floyd County. And she had started at what was then Iowa State.
Is there an urban Rockford?
I don't, that's a good question. She was the oldest in her family. She started at Iowa State Normal. I think it was a teacher's college. She dropped out because the Depression hit when she was 20. She finished at Iowa State. The yearbook that we have, the Iowa State yearbook, is called The Bomb. She was hired by the Iowa State Extension Service to be an extension agent. And for those of us who are familiar with Iowa State and the Morale Act that was passed at the height of the Civil War, the idea of extension was you took your education to rural areas, and this is true not only in Iowa but across the country. So she came to Emmitsburg, single, Protestant, which in Emmitsburg was a big deal. Emmitsburg's the sister city of Dublin, Ireland. So she met my father. I guess I'm really a rural person because she sent my father, according to family lore, at the sale barn. They got married in the parsonage of the Catholic, wherever the priest was in Rockford, with I think four or five people present because my mother hadn't seen the light yet to join the Catholic Church. And they got married in September of 1940.
And your dad was a farmer, is that
my
right?
My dad was a farmer. The Pratts, my grandfather Pratt, came from a disputed area. It goes back and forth between England and Scotland. And he came to the United States in the late 1890s, having gone to Canada first and then down to the United States. And he came to Emmitsburg and married a daughter of one of the first families of Emmitsburg, the last name being Brennan. So you had, he purchased a farm, actually I think it was 40 acres. So you had an English farmer with an Irish hired man. Which is not the way it's supposed to work, but that's the way it was. So anyway, they lost the farm during the Depression. My uncle, there were eight in my father's family, my uncle was the oldest boy. He actually was in the First World War. My uncle was named Joseph Roland Pratt. He came home from the war and attended law school at the University of Minnesota because it was closer to Palo Alto County, Emmitsburg, than Iowa City was. Couldn't get a job after he graduated from the University of Minnesota. For years, we'd visit my uncle in Minneapolis, and he kept talking about Dean Frazier. Well, it was only later that I put together that Dean Frazier was Don Frazier, the mayor's father. So that was the only person in that side of the family that had any education. The oldest in my father's family was kind of Mary Donahue. She was born in 1895, and she lived to be 107. She outlived all of her siblings. And Rosemary and I never get back to Emmitsburg anymore, but she was my last living relative there. So I guess that's a long answer about Emmitsburg, but...
So you grew up on the farm?
I grew up...
A 40-acre farm.
It's very difficult to claim it was... this gets back to your rural and urban thing, Michael, because it's very difficult to claim that it's rural, because now as you look out the Wild Rose Casino, you can see the old Pratt farm.
Is it still a farm?
It's still a farm. My brother-in-law made his... My older sister is married to one of seven boys. He was a farm manager. So when my mother died, they bought the farm. So yes, it's still in my family because my brother-in-law and sister own it. So, but it wasn't very far from town. I delivered newspapers. I rode my bicycle to town. I delivered the Register and Tribune. I got, quote, increases and that kind of thing.
So what was the house like? Were there books? Were there...
It was a tiny, tiny house that shuttered in the winter. And, my brother and I shared a bedroom. My sisters shared a bedroom. I had two sisters and a brother. My brother and I are 14 months apart.
But were there books to read?
Yeah, there were books to read. My mother was a voracious reader. And my father read the newspaper, even though I don't think he had a high school degree. My father read the newspaper voraciously. He was a big reader. Our life was full of reading and talking about, quote, public interests. And, you know, we had this kind of duo, if you will. You know, I think for people who didn't grow up in the 50s, they don't get what a huge dichotomy, unfortunately, there was in the United States. I mean, religion kind of marked you, particularly if you were in a small town. And
In Emmitsburg, yeah, it was primarily Catholic.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Did you do well? Did you go to Catholic, were there Catholic
no,
schools
I didn't go
in Emmitsburg?
I went to public school.
Were there Catholic schools in Emmitsburg?
Oh, yeah. It's closed now, but there was a Catholic school.
Emmitsburg then was a town of about 3,600, and
yes,
it still is.
Yeah. Well, I think it's lost population, Michael, since my guess it's about 3,300 people now. Yeah. I mean, the high school classes have like halved in, when my mom left Extension Service in the 70s, this is before the farm crisis. You know, I think by the time the farm crisis got over, the number of farmers was halved, and there's a main street, but there's no vibrant economy. Like, you can't buy a pair of shoes in the town.
Did you like school?
I did.
Did you do well?
No. Well, I think I did well. I didn't do as well as my sister, but my sister was a very good student. I was in the top part of the class. I wasn't the valedictorian, but I did well. I particularly did well in social studies, history. I wasn't a big science person.
And then you went off to area college?
Yes.
In Mason City?
Yeah. No, in Emmitsburg. There were two campuses, Emmitsburg and Estherville. The reality is we didn't have any money. My mother made probably $9,500. My father didn't make very much money. It was primarily a matter of money is the reason that both my brother and I began our education at the area college.
Which in those days weren't area colleges.
No.
It
no.
was the junior college in Emmitsburg.
Yeah, but Jack Kibbe was the kind of driving force. Harold Hughes was governor. They were kind of the driving force.
For the record, Kibbe was a longtime legislator from Emmitsburg.
Yes, exactly, and a family friend. And so we knew the Kibbes very well. And, that was the primary reason, I would say.
And where did this, as we trace through your life, you had this abiding interest in politics.
Yeah.
Where did you get that?
Well, JFK was a huge deal. When he was elected president, it was, a very big, big deal, particularly the religion issue and, my mother was very liberal, and you know, the race issue was quite morally compelling, and the civil rights movement was, you know, the freedom riders of the early 60s. I can remember going to be a senior in high school. Kennedy had been murdered. They murdered the civil rights workers in Mississippi that summer. I mean, you had to be kind of dead not to realize what was going on, even in a
time. But you were like 9 years old when Kennedy was...
I was 13. I was 13 years old. 1947, I was born.
You were 13 when?
1960, when Kennedy was elected.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
And so you... Two years at junior college, then over to Loras.
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah. Oh, the priest told me it was the place I should go. We had an old Irish priest named Clarence Farley. You'd ask Father Farley, and of course, people don't realize this now, the Catholic Church moves people, but, you know, he was there for like 40 years. I mean, they didn't put a stop sign in town without asking him. And I once asked Father Farley.
Was there a stop sign in town?
Yeah, there was. Okay. And there was a stoplight. I asked Father Farley, where are you from? And he said, the west side. That was the west side of Chicago. You know? He had gone to Loras College, class of 1923, Michael.
So two important things happened to you at Loras College.
Yeah.
The most important was you met Rosemary Vito.
I did.
The second most important was you got involved in politics.
I did, yeah.
Both of those have been enduring influences on your life to this day.
Let me put it this way, Michael. I've been very lucky, and I married up. I mean, is there a better way to say that?
Tell me about, before we talk about Rosemary, tell me about politics at what did you do? How did you got this political bug somewhere, because throughout your life, it's been there until you had to suppress it when you became a judge.
Yeah. Well, I haven't done very well at that sometimes. I was very involved in the Young Democrats. The Young Democrats on each college campus wasn't limited to Loras. The Young Democrats were a very active organization. I got very involved in it. I can remember we had a mock convention, and of course the Republicans were the ones, at least at that time, that didn't have a nominee. LBJ was supposed to be the agreed upon nominee. It turned out not to be the case, but at any rate, we had a mock convention, and I remember how active we were in that. In any event, and John Culver was the congressman, Harold Hughes was the governor. You know, they were people who you could look up to. I was very lucky to get when I graduated from Loras, and the commencement speaker was Otto Kerner, he of the Kerner Commission, which was huge. Later indicted and convicted, he was a Seventh Circuit judge. I got a scholarship. Each year, Fred Schwingel sponsored 8 young Democrats.
For the record, Fred Schwingel was a Republican congressman from Davenport.
Yeah, and a very pro-civil rights. He styled himself as a Lincoln scholar, and he was.
He was, yes.
When you go over the bridge now at Davenport, you're crossing the Fred Schwingel Bridge. At any rate, there were 8 young Democrats who got a scholarship to spend a week in Washington, and 8 young Republicans. So what was... I was so lucky. So we got to attend the last decision day of the Warren Court. And if you didn't have an interest in the law by this time, you know, and there was also a debate in the Senate on Warren Burger's confirmation because Earl Warren had quit the year before and they couldn't get a nominee through. So all that was happening when I was in Washington for that 1 week. And it was the first time I was ever on an airplane. I was 22 years old, so.
And then where did you meet Rosemary? She was at Clark College,
She was at Clark College.
The sister college of
Loras.
Yes,
yeah. It was all women at the time, and Loras was all men. And Rosemary was the beneficiary of the Rizzuti Sarcone Scholarship. And so she... I was my roommate, I had an African-American roommate and a Polish roommate, a guy from Sioux City, Adamovich, and a African-American from Chicago named George Wilson. So Steve Adamovich lined me up with his girlfriend's roommate, who happened to be Rosemary. So,
and so. You got out of, did you get married right when you got out of college?
No. We had a parting of the waves, and I went to law school, and she went to, she taught school in the Twin Cities when she got out of college. She taught at a place called, she taught in Edina, my uncle who lived in Minneapolis called it Our Lady of Cadillacs. It was a Catholic school in Edina.
So why did you go to law school? First of all, yeah. You chose Creighton to go to law school.
Yeah.
Catholic law school, sort of a natural step from Loras.
Well, no, I didn't have any money, and my mother had, now this is, my mother had, of all things, a third cousin named Ruth. Her maiden name was Grievish. She had had a husband named C.I. Jones. C.I. Jones, following the flood of 1927, made a fortune building levees on the Mississippi River. He died, left her money. She married another person named Caldwell. It was later Caldwell County Furs because there's a Des Moines connection. So my grandmother, who was placed in a home in Lincoln, Nebraska, where Ruth Cadwallader lived. It was Cadwallader Furs, that's it. She said, if you go to Creighton, I'll pay your tuition.
Oh.
Well. I said, well, I just have
an offer you couldn't refuse.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
So you obviously liked law school.
I love law school.
And you did well.
I did well. Yeah, I was very lucky. I wrote for the Law Review. I worked at Legal Aid. We had, you know, it was during the time there was a lot of change on the Supreme Court. Justice Blackmun got appointed to the Supreme Court during the time I was in law school. The fellow who got his seat was from Omaha. There was a wonderful judge who later became Chief Judge of the Eighth Circuit, who was Judge Lay, and he was very much connected with the law school, even though he wasn't a Creighton law grad. And so I was very lucky to, I liked law school, yeah.
And when you got out, you went to work for Legal Aid right away.
I did.
In Des Moines.
In Des Moines, yeah.
Why not Omaha? I mean, why? Because Rosemary's family was from here?
Yeah. And, you know, I didn't have...
Were you back with Rosemary by that, that point?
Yeah. Yeah. We were married in 1971.
While you were still in law school.
While I was still in law school. Our wedding anniversary is, we'll be married 50 years on Saturday. And so...
For the record, Saturday is August 7th of 2021.
Yeah. Well, I tell people that. And the next day, Richard Nixon put on price controls. So neither one of us had a car when we got married. My mother bought us a car, a 1967 Ford Falcon, for $500. And Rosemary was teaching in Minneapolis and had no car either. And so we thought we were doing really well to have a car when we got married. But we came to Des Moines because, you know, her family, and Michael, you know this, being in Des Moines, her family was very, well, you could walk up and down Granger and Dunham. They lived at 603 Southeast Dunham, across from what was then the South Des Moines Little League. Her dad was the Little League announcer. And you could walk up and down Dunham and you could meet most of her family. And what was particularly compelling was her grandfather was Giuseppe Nicolino, and he lived on Granger right by the Laconas. And the first time I met him, you went to the Granger side of the house and had a G. You went to the 4th Street side and had an N. So there was, you know, and we were, you know, we obviously thought about having children. And, you know, I missed having aunts and uncles and grandparents close by. And, you know, in Des Moines, I I always tell people that, you know, about Nebraska, I said, I never had any state pride till I moved to Nebraska.
Because, and the pride was in Iowa.
Yeah, yeah. Because we were Iowans, right. And the politics in Iowa were competitive. They weren't in Nebraska, and we just came to Des Moines.
And you got a job in legal aid because you'd been working for legal aid in Nebraska.
Yeah.
What was your first case? First of all, how much money were you making?
My salary was $9,000 a year.
And this was in 1973?
1973, and at the end of my first year, I still have the letter from Bob Oberbillig, who was my first boss.
And remains your friend?
Yeah, and he did. And he got me, I got a raise to $13,000 a year for 1974. And Rosemary taught at St. Augustine's School. She knew people, and so she got hired at St. Augustine. So, you know, now where we live, we always tell people we live at 4316 Grand. We always tell people we're right back where we started.
Yeah, right next door to St. Augustine's.
We only had one car, and so I'd drop her off at work before I'd go to work. So,
and what was your first case in legal aid?
Well, I'm sure it was a divorce case, Michael, because we did so many divorces. As you know, poverty, the handmaidens of poverty are divorce and bankruptcy. And so I did a lot of divorce work. I did a lot of, you know, the tragedy. The years I was at legal aid, three or four women got murdered each year because this was before domestic violence was out of the closet, so to speak. The sheriff would not, you'd get a restraining order against an abusive spouse, and the sheriff, the threatened wife would call the sheriff, and the sheriff would say, well, that's a civil matter, we're not getting involved. They wouldn't enforce restraining orders. There was no domestic violence legislation to speak of. So, you know, you got calls at all hours of the day and night from very frightened, for the most part, women. So it was a learning experience.
And was it a depressing experience, or were you, did it make you feel good that you were helping these people? How did that, what was the impact on you?
Well, you'd go, many divorces were default divorces. Husbands disappeared, didn't show up once you got them served with papers. So I'd go to the courthouse very early in the morning, and the very, very first thing is you'd, quote, prove up default divorces. So I got to know judges very well. And there were some judges who were very supportive of legal services and others who were very opposed to the idea of legal services. And so I learned a lot from those judges. You know, I prove up, I remember Judge Wade Clark, who was a wonderful judge. You know, he used to tell me, he says, Bob, you're gonna learn as you go through life in the practice of law that truth is stranger than fiction because of what you hear. So yeah, I learned a lot from, you know, we had contested contested custody matters. And so I learned to put on evidence, cross-examine, all the tools that you learned in law school. We didn't get to try jury cases, which is what I wanted to do. But I learned a great deal from, you know, I wasn't poverty-stricken like my clients were. And, you know, it also gave you some sense when you were, the very first thing you had to do was fill out a financial form where you questioned them about their resources, assets. And, you know, you'd say, you know, I'm sorry you're not eligible for legal services. And they would say, by the way, it wasn't legal services at the time. That didn't come along till later. This was still OEO funded. Anyway, you'd get to the bottom of the sheet, and it turned out they had too many resources, and you'd say, well, I'm sorry, we can't represent you. I can make a referral to the Bar Association. And they would say, do you mean I have to go to a real lawyer? So, you know.
Somewhere along the way, you were there for 2 years in legal aid.
Yes.
Somewhere you spent time before all these judges and talking to it. Was there ever a germ that, gee, I'd like to be a judge?
Mm-mm.
Gee, I would never like to be a judge?
Uh-huh.
Or gee, I would hate to be a judge?
No, I didn't want to be a judge because, you know, the idea of solitary confinement and being alone and, you know, really I didn't think about being a judge until, you know, I got to do a lot of work in federal court because of just happenstance. You don't end up in federal court unless you're lucky. And, you know, when I got to, and this is not in any way I don't think federal judges are any better and sometimes not as good as state judges. It was just the subject matter, and you know, I was there because I was doing indigent criminal defense work. I was there because I was representing the disabled, and it was kind of, if you will, you know, good versus evil. I don't know what it is about.
So, and that's, and that began in 75. You went into private practice in 75, and you were in private practice for 22 years.
I was.
And criminal, civil?
No. I did both. I did criminal defense work because there was an old Irish lawyer named J. Riley McManus, and he had had a long history of criminal defense work, and one of the lawyers I was with, Jim Brick, knew Riley very well. Riley would say, "Young man, the taxpayers have an obligation to teach you how to try a lawsuit." I said, "Okay." So I got on the criminal appointment list for both state and federal court. And so there was no federal defender. There was barely a state
this
defender.
This is for the do-good list. I mean,
no. This is you got paid. You got paid by the county, because under Gideon versus Wainwright and that series of cases, the state had to reimburse you.
But it was pro bono work, more or less.
No, it wasn't. You got paid. I got paid. That was a bit my biggest. I mean, we had the Tribune used to run a list every year of how much money criminal defense lawyers were getting from Polk County.
And you were on the list.
Well, I wasn't up there. I mean, I remember the names that were up there, but I did a lot of criminal defense work, and I got to do criminal cases in both state and federal court.
What was the first criminal case you had?
You know, I think the first criminal case I had was probably an OWI case, operating while intoxicated. Bob Albee got appointed to the district court by Governor Ray in 1975, just the time I started trying criminal cases. I was so lucky. I got to try 5 criminal cases. Bob was only on the district court for 2 years because he went to the Court of Appeals, started in 76. He may not even been there 2 years. So I got to try 5 criminal cases in Judge Albee's court, and I did some of the most, you know, foolish things in retrospect that you could do. But Judge Albee was the kind of person, first of all, his temperament, the way he treated people, everybody, defendants, janitors, you know, that, you know, Bob would sit down with me after the time for appeal had run or the case was over, and he would critique, you know, he would be very helpful. But
that remains a friend to this day.
He's my friend to this day. But he wasn't unique. Pete Donato was the same way. I mean, once you got by the gruffness and the with Judge Donato, he was the same way. He was very helpful. He liked legal aid. A.B. Crouch was the same way. He was gruff, but once you, you know, sat down with him and said, you know, I mean, I was learning so much from them at the time, but those three in state court were really mentors to me, and Bob still is to this day. He's 92, and I still stay in touch with him because just the manner of his dealings and his civility, you know, was so compelling. And when he went on the court, the Court of Appeals and then the Supreme Court, he always, even though he was on the Supreme Court and I was still a lawyer, when he left the Supreme Court, he wrote me a letter telling me why he was leaving the Supreme Court, even though I was nothing. And so, yeah, I learned a lot from those judges.
What? What did you learn?
Judge Crouch used to say, "Pratt, there's no rule that says you have to cross-examine." I mean, example, you know, your bank robber client has stuck a shotgun in the teller's face. What could you possibly do except make your situation worse, you know? And, you know, I without making too much of it, you know, I mean, Bob, you know, Bob Albee, in a case I had called Jeffries, Bob set aside a guilty verdict against my client because the state of Iowa had gagged. I had a diminished capacity defense for John Jeffries. The dad worked at Mitchell Transmission, and they were Jim Brick's client. So this was an armed robbery. So I had an expert witness named Levesque, and he said how much they drank, and they were doing marijuana, and how he couldn't form the intent to rob this bank. Meanwhile, the prosecution had gagged his co-defendant, who had already pled guilty, and said, "We're not going to call the this as a person as a witness, and neither can you." So he wouldn't let me call the agreement. Would not let me call the other defendant as a witness to corroborate my theory about he was too drunk to form intent. So the jury got convicted. I filed a motion for a new trial. Bob set aside the verdict and said the state can't be gagging witnesses. So this is, humor has very little to do with our work. And sometimes we make mistakes, but I remember when Bob and I have talked this since, when he was sentenced the second time, and it was kind of a rule in Polk County, if you got convicted of robbery with aggravation, you got 25 years in prison. And so when he was sentencing Olin Jeffrey after the first jury was out like a day, the second jury was out like an hour, Judge Albee said to the defendant, "Well, Mr. Jeffrey, you've been convicted now by 24 people." So those kinds of lessons about cross-examination, wasting time, I sometimes want to hold up a sign, and this comes from Bob Albee as well. We got it the first time. Jurors, lawyers are repetitive because, we don't think they got it the first time. I want to reemphasize that. We got it the first time. And wasting time on voir dire, jury examination. I spent a lot of time on jury examination because you can learn a lot, like Yogi says, by listening. If you listen to the jurors, but asking them and trying to pledge jurors like people still try to do in state court is a huge mistake. Those kinds of things that, treating the other side with respect, even if you don't like their case, I don't know, it's common sense, but you mature as a lawyer just the way you mature as a human being. And you do that, you don't know anything when you get out of law school, at least I didn't. And so, when you have people that I had, and then, federal court at the time had W.C. Hansen and W.C. Stewart. We had two judges, and Judge Hansen was kind of the Judge Crouch of the Southern District of Iowa, very gruff. Judge Stewart, on the other hand, had been on the Iowa Supreme Court, had been a state legislator, and was kind of the opposite. But they as well were kind of welcoming. They liked lawyers. They had enjoyed the practice of law. Sometimes I'd have conflicts between state and federal court. I'd be appointed in both places, and Judge Donato would be upset. I had a two-week trial in front of Judge Stewart, ended up going to the Court of Appeals. It's in the books as United States versus Graham. We argued the appeal at the Iowa Law School. Anyway, Judge Donato was insistent, "Pratt, you have to get over here," referring to Polk County, "right away. This case originated before your case." So I went in to see Judge Stewart before trial started, and I said, "Judge, I don't know what to do." He picked up the phone and he said, "Pete," he just cut through all this stuff. And so, those kind of human relationships that you learn.
And during this era, you and Rosemary both became pretty heavily politically involved.
Yes.
Explain that, doing what and for what causes and for what reasons and involving whom?
Well, the war was still going quite strongly when we got out of law school.
First of all, we're talking about the Vietnam War.
Yeah, the Vietnam War. And that didn't end until, the spring of 75. And then, the Watergate thing was, we were both addicted to watching Sam Ervin at night on Channel 11, because of the Watergate thing. And, reforms were coming about both the state and federal levels about the way you ran campaigns and money and the ethics, at least, were trying to be changed about the way. So it was, we were, I guess you'd call cultural Democrats. And so we got involved in Rosemary taught at St. Augustine's, and The recorder of Polk County was Katie Schinstein, and her kids went to St. Augustine. So, you know, first thing you know, we're over there posting yard signs. And the way I got to know Jim Brick, who was the Polk County chairman, is that Katie Schinstein and his wife were big friends. So, you know, I got to know Jim Maloney. The good thing about my interest in politics at the time was that all the office holders were in the courthouse. Now they're not in the courthouse. So when you went to the courthouse, you saw people who were elected officials, Jim Maloney. To get paid on a criminal defense case, you had to get your check from Maloney's office. And of course, Jim Sarcone Sr. was the budget director. And of course, you know, I was kind of a stepchild. I mean, I was married to an Italian-American. I was an Italian-American. But, you know, you got to know your way around the Polk County Courthouse. And, many of those people in the Polk County Courthouse were involved. And, you know, Jim Maloney, the first time we met Jimmy Carter, my wife and I, was October of 75. And Maloney had invited us to a fundraiser. He lived on Harwood. And so we were before the Jefferson Jackson Day dinner, and you know, first thing we're meeting Jimmy Carter and all these candidates from the caucus, even though uncommitted beat him, it was still a big deal. And so.
And who were you supporting? Who were you and Rosemary supporting?
I got to drive Stuart Symington to the JJ dinner. I think we caucused for uncommitted. We weren't Carter people. We may have been for Shriver, because we were Kennedy people, and we may have been for Shriver. I'd have to ask her.
Who was Kennedy's brother-in-law?
Right, right. And he had been the 72 vice presidential candidate.
And speaking of Shriver, let me back up just a minute here. Shriver was the first director of the Peace Corps, which meant something to your family because. Yeah.
Well, my mother joined the Peace Corps. My mother was the subject of a mandatory law requiring her to retire at 65, which she didn't want to do. So immediately after retiring, she joined the Peace Corps and did 2 years in Jamaica at the Peace Corps.
Left your father back on the farm.
Yeah, and she did. And, you know, my father by that time was, my father was 73. So, you know.
Not that that's old.
Yeah, that's not old. I don't think it's old at all.
And so she up and joined the Peace Corps.
Yeah, she did. And then she got home and, you know, this retired Peace Corps volunteer is a huge deal. At least it was to my mother. And she was also going to the, what do they call it? I don't even think they have it anymore. They call older citizens legislature. Do they call that OIL? Or it used to be older citizens legislature. She got really involved in that.
And somewhere along the line, probably early, You met Tom Harkin.
I did.
Where and when and how?
You know, my guess is it was probably in Council Bluffs at the Pottawatomie Democratic headquarters. I was in law school.
And he?
He was running. You know, when he first came back, I think it was, he was undecided. Did he want to go to Ames? Or did he want to go to the district?
When he came back, you mean when he came back from the service?
Well, when he came back, they were going to law school in D.C.
Oh, okay, that's right.
Yeah, when they came back from D.C., I think they had, I don't know this. But anyway, the first place I met him was Council Bluffs. And, you know, we got involved in the campaign. And, you know, he was the Democratic nominee. And
but you didn't you work with him?
Yeah, I did. I did.
At Legal Aid?
I did. I did. He, Tom was, we when we started at Legal Aid, both of us, the offices were split. There were three offices. There was 1500 Grand Avenue on the east side. There was 507 Shops Building downtown. And there was 1307 21st Street out by Drake. So Bob Oberbillig, you know, and money was tight because of the Congress. Bob Oberbillig combined all three offices and we moved to 102 East Grand Avenue. So, and that was quickly after I got there. And Tom Harkin was doing lobbying in the legislature, the Democrats actually done relatively well in 72. McGovern actually did much better than people anticipated. So there were a lot of Democratic, young Democratic people. The big one of the issues that was huge at the time was the usury statute in Iowa. Attorney General Turner had sued Yonkers over the proper interest rate. And so that year they passed what is now Chapter 537, the Uniform Consumer Credit Act. And Tom Harkin lobbied on behalf of legal aid at that. He also did other work. But yes, I worked with him, got to know him.
Became friends.
He spent a lot of evenings out in the district. His wife was I think they had a 59 Cadillac. And they lived on Ontario and Ames, I think it was. So yeah, we did get to know him.
And that proved beneficial to your career.
Michael, you and I have talked about this, and I have with my friends as well. You know, I'm very lucky to have been able to have this job. And, you know, I like to think, and, you know, talking about yourself like my friend Dick Lyford and you have talked me into is not, I hope it's not my forte, but I like to think that I'm a blue-collar kind of lawyer that I have to work hard to try to figure it out. And I like to, the Mendoza line in baseball is very important to me. You got to hit at least 190 to stay in the big leagues, because if you can't hit 190, you're not going to stay up here. So I like to think that my lawyering skills and trying to get it right get me to the Mario Mendoza line. But one who does not acknowledge that patronage plays a large part in securing a nomination and a confirmation isn't dealing with reality.
Well, why do you think he nominated you?
Well, I think because he sees the law the same way I do, that egalitarian principles about the way the law should treat people is important. And, you know, the law, for the most part, is inaccessible to the vast, vast majority of people. And I think I come from blue-collar people. I think he does. I think that, frankly, I think Senator Harkin was ahead of his time picking people who had been at legal aid and federal defenders. Now, you know, here it is 25 years later, and you hear the current administration saying, well, we want federal defenders, we want legal services people. And so I think that, you know, Michael, I've talked to you about this, but the idea that, I'm around people and my insecurity shows me, you know, people went to Harvard and Yale and Stanford, and I have to keep in mind my Eleanor Roosevelt quote that no one can make you feel inferior without your consent, because they've had great experiences. They've clerked on the Supreme Court. They've done this. They've done that. But I've had unique experiences. I've been with people who've gone through bankruptcy. I've been with people who have lost custody of their children. I've been with people that have been convicted of terrible crimes. I think he appointed me, and he and I have never had the discussion about it, but I think he appointed me because I try to have empathy for people who appear in front of me.
I asked him the other day why he appointed you and what he looks for in a judge. I'd like to show you what he said.
Okay.
Senator, in your many terms in the United States Senate, you served. Bill Clinton was president for a couple of terms and Obama for a couple of terms, and therefore during those 16 years you had the duty and the opportunity to recommend people to be federal judges. In those 16 years you recommended four people, Stephanie Rose, Bob Pratt, Mark Bennett, and Jane Kelly to the Eighth Circuit.
Mark Bennett.
I'm curious, what do you look for when you send a name up to the president? What kind of person did you look for?
I think more than anything, I want someone who understands the frailties of human nature. That isn't just sort of a by the book, what's the law, throw everything at a defendant. I want someone who understands that human beings are, we have frailties. People make mistakes. And sometimes people who make mistakes that are on the bottom rung of the economic ladder are the ones that get hit the hardest.
And what made you think that Pratt, obviously you knew Pratt before you before you nominated him. First of all, how did you get to know him?
I was a legal aid lawyer with Bob Pratt right after I got out of law school and right after he got out of law school. I was a bit older than he was. I had served in the military. But so Bob Pratt and I became lawyers for the Polk County Legal Aid Society, and that's where I first kind of knew him and met him, yes.
And what is it about him that prompted you to have his name first on the list for the federal judgeship here?
Well, first, I remember him as a legal aid lawyer, and he was smarter than I was. He was just a better lawyer. So a lot of times, if I had a tough case, I was always going into his office and asking him, what do I do? So I remember that. I remember the kind of advice and counsel he would give me in handling some cases that were kind of hopeless. After I left there, I became a congressman. And then he left legal aid and became a lawyer for Social Security. So for many years, I would say, oh gosh, maybe, well, how long? Maybe 10 to 15 years, I would go to him periodically on Social Security matters because he represented Social Security recipients who were denied their legitimate claims for Social Security disability. So here I am, I'm working on disability legislation. He knows all about what's happening in the real world with people who are being denied their claims. So I would say every so often, about a couple of years, so something would happen and I would see him here in Des Moines and ask him about Social Security, about disability, and you know, sort of what the problems were and how to solve them. So I kind of kept in touch with him through the years on that basis.
So when the opening arose,
yeah,
how many names did you pass through your head before you settled on him?
Oh gosh, there were quite a few.
You don't have to name names.
Well, I had a committee set up and I said sort of kind of go through the initial influx and weed it down to a certain number for me. I forget, maybe it came down to maybe seven people, something like that, that was sort of kind of came to me that I had to make a decision.
And in a situation like that, is there a lot of lobbying?
Yeah, I'm gonna think about it.
Yeah. Who can recall who lobbied for Pratt or against him?
Well, yes, I can remember that. I remember some of my former legal aid people, the attorneys.
For him or against him?
For him. Oh, yeah, they were for him. And the head of our legal aid at that time was very strong for Bob Pratt.
Who was that?
Bob Oberbilly.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah. He was very strong for Bob.
What do you think, Judge?
Well, you know, I think that, you know, he's right about trying to understand that the law is not always considerate of the economic circumstances of, you know, people when they get involved in both the criminal law and the inaccessibility of our system to civil litigants. And, you know, I wrote an article about this because The only time that poor people appear in federal court, Michael, is when they're criminal defendants or whether they're asking us to review their disability denial. And, you know, you have to remember the oath that every federal judge takes says, I promise to do equal right to the poor and to the rich alike. And I always tell people, you got to understand, the poor come first in that phrase. So, you know, I did have an occasion once in the Court of Appeals when I was the last person arguing. You have like five or six cases set in the Court of Appeals. And I was arguing a Social Security disability case, and I did tell the panel, I said, you know, I've been listening to the arguments, because you do learn a lot by sitting there watching other lawyers not do very well in oral arguments. I did tell the panel, I said, you know, I was here earlier. I said, those were all rich people. I said, I'm here for the poor people now. So then I quoted the statute, which I think it's 28 U.S.C. 22. I don't even know what the citation is now, but it does say equal right to the poor and to the rich alike. So,
you've been a federal district judge or senior judge for nearly 25 years now.
I have. I started my 25th year on July 1 and my 10th year as a senior judge on July 1. So.
Right. And so I just want to look back a bit. Again, what was your first case? Were you nervous? Was it a jury trial?
Yes.
And how did it come out?
It was a jury trial. It was the very first case. I was very lucky because the two lawyers, and the one thing I've learned, I knew this going in, but it's comes up every day, the best thing a judge has in any case are the capability of the lawyers. If you have good lawyers, you know, it's not an easy job, but it's a much less stressful job if you have good lawyers. So I had very good lawyers. The case was a criminal case. It was called United States of America versus Jonathan Gilbert. Jonathan Gilbert had landed at the Omaha airport, and I think because of the bend in the river, it you meander if you're coming to either Omaha or Council Bluffs, you meander into Iowa.
Carter Lake, I think.
Carter Lake, thank you. And so anyway, he stopped, he got a speeding ticket, and they asked for identification, and he was a former ATF agent. He was an African-American person. And so he tried to get out of it by saying, well, I'm an ATF agent, I shouldn't be getting a speeding ticket. They indicted him for impersonating a federal officer. So after trial—
Because he was a former.
He wasn't a current agent. So the jury convicted him. The defense lawyer was Nick Dries, a wonderful lawyer. He had been a Don O'Brien law clerk. I knew Nick pretty well. His father was later a Democratic representative from Carroll. The prosecutor was Mary Luxa. They both knew it was my— I had been a judge 5 days. I think the trial was July 6th. I started July 1st. And so they were both incredibly understanding. The jury convicted. I gave him probation. I found a letter that he had written me a year later thanking me for probation. But that was the very first case I tried. It was a jury trial, and the jury convicted him. Yeah.
In those early years, who did you look to for advice? Who were your mentors, so to speak? Yeah. Which college colleagues did you especially admire?
Well, again, I was very lucky. I had Judge Viator, Judge Woolley, Judge Longstaff. But we have wonderful magistrates. Ross Walters, very capable judge, Celeste Bremer. We had a very collegial group. I could go to any of them, and I did go to all of them over the years and share my frustrations and concerns. And, you know, it was difficult, you know, I'm thinking of Ed Devitt's 10 rules for the new judge. You know, once you get the job, you shouldn't whine and say, oh, they forced me to take this job, so I don't want this to come off that way. But, you know, when you go from an intense people kind of practice of law, going to court, taking depositions, working with your colleagues who are lawyers, you know, and you go from that to this place that nobody comes to, the federal courthouse, you know, it's a huge adjustment. It's not quite as bad as being an appellate judge, but there's not, you know, most of your days are spent in front of a computer. You know, a judge, Mark McCormick, who I've known over the years, Mark told me before I started, he said, you know, you're going to realize that a lot of judging is tedious work. And so, to answer your question, all of those judges, magistrates, and Article III judges, I could call, go to their chambers, sit down with them. But people on the Court of Appeals were that way. You know, Judge Fagg was very welcoming to me. When I started, he was in the annex. You know, Richard Arnold, I'd gotten to know because I'd argued cases in front of him. He was a judge I could call, and I did call.
He was on the Eighth Circuit from
Arkansas.
He was on the
Eighth Circuit, and the first year I was on the court, I got to sit on a panel of the Court of Appeals with Judge Arnold. And I was so lucky, he invited myself and my law clerks to go to dinner with him. And Judge Arnold was just a giant of the federal judiciary. He, across any kind of partisan lines, you know, his relationship with President Clinton, he was humorous, he was tactful, he was civil, he was, okay. And I remember at dinner that night, I said to him, Judge, because I couldn't call him Richard, I said, Judge, every time I read about you, you're in the New York Times, President Clinton was president, he says, you're in the New York Times playing golf with President Clinton. And I said, they always refer to you as a Clinton crony. And Judge Arnold said, cronyism is what made this country great.
And by his definition, it was cronyism that put him on the court.
You're exactly right. You're exactly right. But I mean, here's a guy who's number one in all everything, and he still was kind of self-deprecating, self-effacing by saying, "Hey, my merit was I knew a U.S. senator." That was.
I want to just go back a second here. Earlier, you said that you talked about I can't remember the exact context, but you said. Being a judge could be like being assigned to solitary confinement.
Yeah, yeah.
Now that you're a judge here, you've been a judge for a while, was it solitary confinement?
Well, it was in the sense that your lifestyle changes.
No politics.
No politics. And I think it's inhibiting if you're a social person and you've spent your life doing social things, you know, I mean, many things I have not handled well. You know, I don't need to tell you that, but, you know, you should get a lot more training than you've had about how to adapt. I was 50 years old when I started, so I like to think, well, I'm mature, but I did. You know, looking back at it, I did foolish things that I wished I could have back, both in terms of decisional law, in terms of the way I handled things. I mean, unless you have acknowledged your mistakes, you can't ever improve. So the social part of it was difficult. You know, the many lawyers that you know throughout your work that you've spent 25 years with say, well, you know, let's have lunch someday. Well, they never call you because they're busy. You know, I like to think that, you know, I was lucky because I had friends, frankly, like you, who, you know, were helping me. You know, I could talk to people about non-lawyer things and even politics and not get in trouble. But It is a huge adjustment.
How did it affect Rosemary's life?
Well, December of 96, they have a federal practice seminar every year, and Richard Arnold came that year, and he gave a keynote address, and they have a dinner the night before, so she's sitting next to Judge Arnold, and she knew how much I admired him, and she said to Judge Arnold, she said, well, if he gets confirmed, can I still be involved in politics? And Richard Arnold says, honey, and it wasn't in any kind of dismissive sense, he says, you can do whatever the hell you want. He says, although sometimes he may have to move out of the marital home, whatever that is. So she did well. And she's a very social person, and she loves politics as much as I did. And she would, you know, try to get dates to fundraisers, and, you know, but yeah.
And she worked in politics.
Yeah, she worked
in politics. She worked for Governor Vilsack.
Yeah, she worked for Governor Vilsack, and before that, she worked at the Polk at the Polk County Clerk of Court's office, so she knew, how important politics were to us, and she was also, she's such a hard worker. She's taken care of many cousins and aunts and uncles. She's, and her mother. And so, yeah, she's very capable.
I want to get back now to your years on the bench. I want to ask you about four cases that really stand out to me. In your career, and if you want to add others that you think are more, or if you want to dismiss some of these as not important, I have others that are more important. You've got the Gall case, the Colson case, the wrongful imprisonment case, and a fourth case that I think would add that most people wouldn't is the Sorensen case. Which struck me as important because of the political aspect. But talk about Gall first. Explain the facts and your decision, and then the road up.
Yeah. Well, I did criminal defense work until the late 70s. In fact, Roxanne Conlon and I tried Roxanne's first ever jury trial. It was a criminal case. It's a reported case. It's called U.S. versus Goring. So
did she win or lose?
She won. She won. And I appealed to the Court of Appeals.
She would want me to ask that question, having won.
And she won again in the Court of Appeals. So, no, but at any rate, when I was doing criminal work, the discretion of the trial judge at sentencing was enormous. There was never, the only time a sentence ever got appealed was when the defendant was sentenced to a greater term of imprisonment than the Congress had set. And so there was, turns out, at least scholars say, the myths had arisen that federal judges, and the parole board was quite involved in federal prisoners. When I was doing criminal defense work, if your client got 10 years, he did a third and he's out. The parole board let him out. Well, so the Congress came along, and during the period of the 70s and into the 80s, they debated. There was a famous judge, Marvin Frankel, on the District Court of Southern New York, who wrote a book called Law Without Order. And he made the argument that people are getting disparate sentences in the District of Oregon versus the District of South Carolina. It impacts race and ethnicity. And so scholars argued about this, and without getting into this scholarly argument, the Congress came along and they passed the Sentencing Reform Act of 1984, which Senator Harkin, I've heard him say before, was a mistake, and he voted wrong on it. At any rate, they passed the Sentencing Reform Act of 84 that required that judges sentence within, it wasn't a guideline, it was a mandatory directive from Congress. If you find these facts, you must give this sentence. It became effective November 1st of 1987. I became a judge July 1st of 1997. I didn't know anything that had happened. The very first time I think I'm on the bench, they brought a defendant in. He wanted to make bond, and the U.S. attorney got up and says, "Well, Your Honor, let me tell you about the presumption." So I said, "Well, counsel, I know all about the presumption of innocence." No, no. The Congress had passed the Bail Reform Act of 84, which required if you were accused of this crime, you are detained. You cannot get out. The presumption of innocence is over. So they had not only, they had changed all of this, and they had taken discretion away from district judges. And so I was shocked by what I was, very surprised by what I had to do, because the cases usually presented the dilemma of how much was embezzled, how much drugs were involved, you know, all of these special factors now that you had to take into account at sentencing to arrive at a guideline that was binding on the district court. And if you didn't give a sentence within this guideline that the Sentencing Commission came up with, you got reversed by the Court of Appeals. So lo and behold, the Academy, a number of scholarly law professors, lawyers, put together an argument that the mandatory guidelines had destroyed the defendant's right to Sixth Amendment jury trial. So the only way to solve it is to, I think the scholars, Michael, called it an eclectic group that couldn't agree on anything else. So you had five on the Supreme Court, Thomas, Scalia, Souter, Ginsburg, and not Breyer. Breyer was a pragmatist. I'm missing one person. White? No, White wasn't there. Anyway, you had five of them from very disparate camps agreeing that, yes, the guidelines are unconstitutional. And in January of 19...
Stevens?
John Paul Stevens. So you had the guidelines being declared unconstitutional by those five members. You had a different five saying the remedy is to strike the mandatory nature of it and the guidelines will now be advisory. The judge has to consider an advisory guideline along with the sentencing factors that the Congress mandated in the statute. And so we district judges thought, well, our hands are untied. This was January of 06. So I had this case, this young man who pled guilty. He had gone.
His name is Gall.
Gall. Brian Michael Gall. It was a working class kid from, I think, Bluegrass, Iowa, over by Davenport. He had gone to the community college in Cedar Rapids, and then he had gone to Iowa, and he was involved in an ecstasy ring. They were selling ecstasy. There were Los Angeles policemen, lawyers from Colorado, college students from Iowa. They were bringing ecstasy from Holland and Spain, Madrid, to the United States, and he was making a lot of money, and he got indicted and cooperated with the Drug Enforcement Administration, graduated from college, did very well in a couple of businesses in Arizona and Colorado, and for confessing to DEA, the government indicted him. So I let him out on bond, and so I got these facts. He voluntarily withdrew from a drug conspiracy. Those are very, very rare facts. People do not withdraw from drug conspiracies. So at sentencing, the advisory guideline told me that I should give him a sentence somewhere between 37 and 46 months, that it was the right sentence. So he had voluntarily withdrawn the conspiracy. He was... when he was indicted, he was in Boulder, Colorado. His lawyer at the trial level was a lawyer named Mark Milovitz, and he argued that he should get probation. The government was very insistent that all these other defendants had gone to trial or pled guilty, and they were getting guideline sentences, so I should give him a guideline sentence. I gave him probation, and unlike most sentences, I wrote an opinion, because the facts were so compelling that by this time the issue had gotten to the Court of Appeals and then to the Supreme Court. There was a competing case of mine called Claiborne versus the United States, where Carol Jackson, a judge in St. Louis, had given a kid a break, much like I did. Well, in the run-up, Claiborne was argued while I was still sentencing Gall. Claiborne gets murdered after the case is argued in the Supreme Court. This is called luck, okay? I mean, I've had a lot of luck, but nothing quite compares with this. So I have these Gall facts. I'm writing an opinion. The issue is going to be decided by the Supreme Court. The argument's been made. Defendant gets murdered in St. Louis. They dismiss the case. They take The Court of Appeals reverses me. The Supreme Court quickly, 11 days
reverses
later...
Reverses you on the Gall case,
yes,
for having given probation.
Probation. So it turns out these academic institutions, Stanford and Northwestern, helped the defendant get a certiorari grant. Cert grants are very tough to come by. And so they had the Stanford Clinic and the Northwestern Clinic. They got a cert grant. They got a large international law firm named Sidley and Austin to represent the defendant in the Supreme Court. And so the argument was, when you have a person that gets sentenced outside the guideline, what is the standard of review? The Court of Appeals had said that it's de novo. We don't have to pay any attention to what the district judge said. The defendant's arguing abuse of discretion. You got to pay some attention to what the district court did. So they argued the case in October. And so this is kind of an aside, but I was on a judicial conference committee, and I'm in a meeting in St. Louis, and Tom Vanaski, who was later on the Third Circuit, comes from a meeting of the Judicial Conference of the United States, and Justice Roberts is there. And of course, this issue is impacting on 80,000 sentences across the country each year. So they're watching Gall very carefully, both Court of Appeals and trial judges who do sentencings. So Judge Vanaski says that the Chief Justice was telling the rest, the other 27 members of the Judicial Conference, that we were going to decide that issue last term, and the defendant was murdered, but we have it up for argument this term. And the Chief Justice said, and I want you to know, all of the justices have an alibi. He does have a good sense of humor. So at any rate, they argued the Gall case in October, and it came down that it was 7-2. Justice Stevens was wrote the opinion.
And who were the two opposed?
Justice Thomas and Justice Alito.
Mm-hmm. And so, did you know, just a little bit of the mechanics, you knew the case was coming down that day?
Mm.
And what did you expect?
No.
Oh, you didn't?
I did not know. Unlike the Iowa Supreme Court, they don't tell you what's coming down.
And what was your expectation?
Well, the facts were awfully compelling, and I knew that very good lawyers were arguing the case, and I knew that, you know, you had a very receptive five judges who thought, you know, there's a legal, part of the legal academy says, this wasn't about the right to a jury trial. This was, the judiciary was taking back what was traditionally theirs. This was real politics, right? And so there's that school of thought. The academics said, no, this was a Scalia idea. At common law, that you could only deprive a person of liberty by the person admitting to everything, or by a jury hearing all of the evidence and determining that he did it. And so I had an expectation that it was going to come out favorably. The week before trial, the same committee that I was just talking to, I belonged to, and we had our meeting, our yearly meeting at Laguna Beach in December. This was the Friday before the Tuesday that it came down, and the judges were, you know, everybody was waiting for it because, you know, we district judges were on hold about, well, what could the Court of Appeals do? Because between Booker and Gall, I had been reversed 9 times.
On this issue, basically.
On this issue. Yeah, because I thought the handcuffs were off. You know.
So when a decision like that comes down, I mean, obviously it pleases you because it's 7 of the 9 Supreme Court justices saying Justice Pratt was right in Des Moines. So it must really please you. Yeah. It probably pleases you as well to see the Eighth Circuit kind of knocked down
right.
a little bit.
Right.
Can you gloat?
Well, you shouldn't, but I
did
think
you?
I did. Yeah, I didn't handle it well. I mean, if I had to do over again, I wouldn't talk to the press. I did not handle it well. I regret that. I wasn't very mature, but yeah, I was hot about it. No, I mean, I have a friend that introduced, I introduced at a disability lawyers conference in Chicago, a court of appeals judge in Chicago, David Hamilton. I introduced him to give a talk to these lawyers. And David says, you know, nobody likes getting reversed. You know, when I talk to judges, Michael, and they say, oh, you know, I don't care if I get reversed. I don't believe that, because everybody has pride in their work, at least they should have. And I like to think I got it right, and I worked hard, and I got it right. I do try to apply the law even when I don't like it. So, yes, I was pleased. Did I gloat? Yes. Should I have? No. But that's life, and you got to move on. You know?
Tell me about the Colson case.
Well, the Citizens United for Separation of Church and State brought a lawsuit against the Iowa prison system. This system had been started by Charles Colson post-Watergate. And the prison ministries was represented by a large Washington firm, I think Atlanta-based. And then they had local counsel here. And the state of Iowa had gotten a contract with IFI, Interfaith Group, to rehabilitate prisoners. And it was a very interesting case because the wall of separation that we talk about actually doesn't appear in the Constitution, and it never appeared in any Supreme Court case until 1947 in Everson versus New Jersey, when they talked about the separation of church and state and busing Catholic school kids using public funds. And so there are two competing clauses, as you know, of the First Amendment religion clause. One is free exercise, and the other is establishment of religion. So the plaintiffs challenged this statute based on the idea that it was establishing religion. So we had a three-week bench trial, no jury. The plaintiff, asked that I declare it unconstitutional because we had a much testimony about the rehabilitation that was made available, about the doctrine that was taught within the confines of the prison, about who had their own keys to cells. And it was a very interesting case. I had very good lawyers, and the plaintiff asked that the money that the state had paid be returned to the Treasury of Iowa, and the state of Iowa was defending the program. So I enjoined the program as violative of the Establishment Clause, and I wrote a long opinion, and I got and then it went to the Court of Appeals, and the panel at the Court of Appeals included Justice O'Connor. Talk about luck, because she's kind of the middle of the court on Establishment Clause, and I had cited many of her cases. So she was on the panel that affirmed my ruling that the program of rehabilitation, violated the Establishment Clause. But the court said that I abused my discretion when I ordered them, the state, to repay the money to the taxpayers, because they said it was a question of what was the appropriate equitable relief, and the state had a good faith belief that they weren't violating the Establishment Clause. So I got reversed on that part of it.
But not on the whole case.
No, not on the finding.
I mean, the case itself established pretty firmly.
Right.
About religion.
Right, right.
Okay, now, I want to ask you about the Council Bluffs false imprisonment case.
Yeah.
Is that the right phrase
yes.
to use?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I want to ask you about it because the facts are interesting, but the lawyers, at least one lawyer, was even more interesting.
Right, right, right.
Tell me about it.
Well, two young people, African-Americans, were convicted in 78 of the murder of a just-retired Council Bluffs police chief, and they had separate trials. They jury convicted both. The lawyer, I think, The lawyer was deceased by the time the case came around in this aspect of it. But the convictions were affirmed by the Iowa Supreme Court in the early 80s or late 70s. So a barber at the Fort Madison prison got involved. Eventually, it was discovered that there was a unnamed prospect that the prosecution knew about that was not turned over to the defense in the criminal cases. The Iowa Supreme Court, Chief Justice Turnus wrote the opinion giving them new trials. Actually, I think Justice Cady dissented in the case. And, you know, so it wasn't an easy case. You know, if you have two people that wise who are dissenting or disagreeing with each other. So at any rate, it was 2003 when the Iowa Supreme Court said they get new trials. Well, a lot of the evidence was gone. It was now 25 years later. So the state decided not to retry them. So both defendants, they had been in, are released from prison. Since there's no criminal case, they were out. And so they brought wrongful conviction cases under Section 1983.
Seeking damages.
And the plaintiff, Terry Harrington, was represented by Jerry Spence in his law firm from Jackson Hole, Wyoming. And the other plaintiff was represented by a Chicago lawyer, Steve Davis, who was a very capable lawyer, and Mr. Spence was very capable as well. But anyway, the case went on for years because of motion practice. This is still an undecided area of law about can the state, if the state presents knowingly, if this prosecution presents evidence that they got in they sued the prosecutors and the police. So the first issue that had to be decided is the law generally says prosecutors have absolute immunity from during the prosecution. You may not sue a prosecutor. Then the Supreme Court came along and said, well, there's a little distinction. If the prosecutor engages in investigative acts, then he or she is subject to liability. There's some Seventh Circuit and a Supreme Court case that says that, Fitzpatrick. So they sued the prosecutors. So I let most of the case go forward, and it was at the Court of Appeals for a long time. And so anyway, they affirmed most of what I did. So the Supreme Court took the case. The Supreme Court took the issue about whether or not the prosecutors could be sued for wrongful conviction based on what they did in an investigative role. The defendants were represented by Mayor Brown, a big Chicago firm. The plaintiff, very interesting, Harrington and McGee, were represented by the Paul Clement, who had just been the Solicitor General for George W. Bush's administration, but he was arguing pro bono that my decision was correct. So I learned subsequent to this that the night before the argument, the plaintiff, I'll have my numbers wrong here, but the night before the argument, the prosecutor's insurance company and the plaintiffs had been arguing about settling the case. So apparently the night before they settled the case, I think they paid $28 million or $20 million, I don't know what they paid. Anyway, they went ahead with the argument anyway. And it turned out 30 days later when they got it settled, they withdrew the writ of certiorari and the issue, they argued the case, but it never got decided about whether or not you could hold the prosecutor liable for that. So that's the end of that prosecution's liability, they settled. So now the case comes back and we have to try the matter of do the police have an independent obligation, yes they do, to turn over the evidence, exculpatory evidence. So we tried the case, started in late October of 2012, and I got a verdict I didn't get a verdict. The jury came back like December 12th. So we tried it for like 6 weeks. And the Spence Law Firm had Harrington Steve Davis had McGee, and I thought, anyway, the jury was hung, is what it amounts to.
But what was it like to have, now this was Jerry Spence's last argument, correct? At least it was supposed to be.
Yeah. And all during the motion practice part of this, I never saw Spence. They have a number of lawyers.
But he came in and he made this big, I mean, there were reporters there from all across the country
Exactly. And he had his own fan club. I mean, he had people flying in from all over the country to watch him.
What influence does that have on you, on a judge?
Well, I mean, I can't answer that without telling you that before the trial started, you know, Jerry Spence purportedly had his last trial in the Eastern District of Michigan. He represented a guy named Jeffrey Figer, who was Dr. Kevorkian's lawyer. Jeffrey Figer had bundled money for John Edwards' campaign, and they indicted Figer. So the judge on the case, Paul Borman, I know pretty well. Paul's a former federal defender in Eastern Michigan. I called him and I said, Paul, what's he like in trial, Jerry Spence? Because I didn't know he was going to show up. And Paul Borman said to me, he says, you know, when you make those rulings about evidence and how you're going to handle things, he said he'll come in the next day and pay no attention to him at all. So Paul Borman said, just buckle your seatbelt. That was his advice. And then Paul Borman went on to say, he said, you know, when you're doing voir dire and the nice woman jurors, prospective juror says to you, I'd really like to serve, but I've got to stay home and take care of Grandpa. Well, once she sees that it's Spence, she won't want to stay home and take care of Grandpa.
He's a showman.
That's what happened.
And how do you filter that out, is my question. I mean,
you don't. That's his M.O. I mean, you try to get him to comply with the law because, you know, that's your job. But, you know, he's a handful. And, you know, I think after the trial, I debriefed with Steve Davis in Chicago one day over coffee. And, you know, his voir dire, Michael, the way he handled himself with the jury was, I mean, I've saved the transcript and shared it with a number of lawyers who've asked for it because it was very compelling, you know, the way he got the jury to, I mean, literally at the end of the voir dire, the jurors were saying, Mr. Spence, I really think I can do a good job in this case.
Yeah, they wanted to be there.
They wanted to. And, you know, his arguments were quite compelling. You know, he's just, I mean, I think it's never right to say over the hill, but I mean, I don't think, you know, I had so many kind of anecdotal things that happened during the trial. Like he wanted a day to make a final argument after the long trial. He said, Mr. Spence, we are not doing that. So he proceeded to inform me that, well, when I tried the Marcos case in New York, Judge Keenan gave me a whole day. So I called Judge Keenan and we exchanged calls while I was on and off the bench. So Judge Keenan told me, well, it was a six-month trial. The government called 170 witnesses. He says, but he said, that's the reason I gave him a day to make the argument. So,
but what impact? I mean, you see lawyers who are really fantastic and far less than fantastic. What impact does that have?
Well, you're taken back because if there is a concept, and I think there is, if there is a concept called charisma, he has it.
No, but let's just talk about your, not him, because he's almost in a class by himself with Edward Bennett Williams and people like that. Yeah. But the lawyers you see day in and day out, mostly are Iowa lawyers.
Yeah.
Some you know to be really, really good. Right. Some you know to be less than good. Right. What impact does that have on you?
Well, when I have really good lawyers, and I do a lot, when I have really good lawyers, it's the best job in the world because, you know, I'm thinking, boy, I didn't see that part of the case. I didn't understand that. And, you know, they're bringing out stuff that their lawyering skills, you know, they always, good lawyers always know much more about the case than I do. That's why I believe so strongly in lawyer voir dire. They ought to be able to talk to the judges of the facts, you know, and not. So the impact is that it just shows you that, you know, I know that the myth is that the lawyer doesn't make any difference. Well, lawyers do make a difference. And the way they work, the way they do discovery, the way they treat people, I mean, from beginning to end. So the impact it has when I have really good lawyers is, wow, you know, this is a great job.
I want to ask you about one more specific case, and that's the Sorensen case, where a legislator was convicted of basically selling his allegiance in the president in a presidential primary campaign, and you gave a what some people thought was a very harsh sentence, and you had a eloquent statement about politics, corruption in politics, obviously deep from your heart. Talk about that.
Well, I had read Zephyr Teachout's a prophet Fordham. She wrote a book on corruption. And Mark Wolf is kind of the leading federal district judge on corruption, and I've gotten to know Mark very well. He's a judge in Boston. And while people think of it, and I'm sure the defendant thought of it as a harsh sentence, it was actually a below-guideline sentence. And
harsh in the terms of other people in the case. Weren't nobody else in the case was sent to prison.
Yes. The other defendants, I think, received either 6 months or 3 months, and another defendant, I think, got probation.
Yes.
But I just think that the facts were so compelling about deterrence and, you know, the Sentencing Commission studies about the way we treat white-collar cases as opposed to, quote, blue-collar, if there is such a term. I just thought, if you look at the factors that you're supposed to in the sentencing statute, that it called for a prison sentence. And it was contrary to what the prosecution wanted. It was contrary, obviously, to what the defense wanted. But, you know, sometimes you have to do what you think is right, even if the lawyers disagree with you. And I thought the sentence was, you know, the statute says that you should give a sentence that is sufficient but not greater than necessary. And I thought that was the right sentence on that day for that defendant.
But you also said, in effect, political corruption is the worst kind of corruption.
Right.
That it endangers democracy.
And I believe that, yeah. And if you read Professor Teachout's book, you know, that's not a partisan concept. Theodore Roosevelt was very much against corruption. Ben Franklin, the book starts off by talking about Ben Franklin and when he came back to the United States about it's in the Constitution for a reason that you don't get anything for being an official except your pay. So,
do you lose sleep before sending someone off to prison?
Yes, I do.
I mean, do you talk it over with anybody? You talk it over with your clerks?
I talk it over with my clerks.
Mike Messina?
Yeah. I talk with both my clerks and Mike, you know.
Mike Rosemary?
No. No. She's got enough on her plate. She doesn't need that. No.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you're messed around with people's destinies here.
Right. You're depriving them of their liberty.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah. If you don't, you know, I think it's the hardest part of the work. And if you don't think, if you are easy with, you know, that's why the guidelines, I think, were so kind of harsh in the sense that it made you think, well, if that commission, that blind commission of seven people in D.C. think it's okay, I don't have to worry about the rest of it. So I think when you have discretion, you always fear that you're going to make a mistake one way or the other because, you know, public safety is an enormous part of a judge's responsibility. You know, letting people who are dangerous loose you know, you should never do. And on the other hand, warehousing people because they've committed a crime is not right either. And, you know, because we haven't yet believed deeply in rehabilitation, you know, you're forced to think about, you know, what's enough here to make it sufficient but not greater than necessary. You know, the concept that the Congress picked is an old common law phrase that they had at common law, sufficient but not greater than necessary. So they, the argument at common law was that every day additional that you give a person in prison, you're depriving them unjustly about what they're entitled to. So, you know, that's why what the Congress has done, and I have to give the past president and the past Congress credit, what the Congress has done with letting us revisit some of these very harsh sentences, you know, people that got sentenced between November 1st of 87 and early 06 are without a remedy. They do not have a remedy.
Have you, I want to ask, first I want to follow up one quick question. Do you have second thoughts on sentencing?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, you got into compassionate release just now.
Yeah.
Have you acted on compassionate relief requests?
Yeah. It's been a real opportunity, and I've talked to colleagues about this. To me, it's been a real opportunity to revisit cases that, you know, you wished now that you didn't have to do then what you did. And, you know, and it's not just compassionate release, pardon me, used to be limited to the warden was the only one with discretion. The Congress amended the statute to permit we judges, upon a showing of compelling evidence, to grant release. And the compelling evidence can be a different sentence now than what was given then. The Congress has amended the statute, health considerations, even considerations about the family. So, you know, I've been working with my probation office because, you know, Judge Arnold used to say about, you're just going 100 miles an hour, you're just hoping you don't make a serious mistake. Well, that's what I'm doing on these cases. So I'm having the probation office, so far, the people I've given, and it's not a long time, have never had further problems. But I'm following up on that because, you know, I tend to, you know, I've got to consider, you know, public safety, and yet I've got to think about what's compelling. And so it's an equal dilemma.
Do they thank you?
You're welcome.
I say, do they thank you?
Yeah, I've gotten some very nice letters. I look around here because I think I brought one. But yeah, I've got some very nice letters from prisoners who have done very well. And yeah, they do thank you. Yeah.
Before we end,
yeah,
I just got a couple of quick questions. In the last 25 years, how have you changed?
Well, I think I've matured, although that's subject to debate. You know, I've tried to, I'm less a social person than I was. You know, my wife and I both read this book 4 or 5 years ago called Younger Next Year. It's by a Dr. Lodge, and Dr. Lodge says that, you know, you got to maintain your social, you know, in addition to taking care of yourself, you got to maintain your social contacts. So I think that my social contacts have diminished. I don't have as many, quote, friends, although as I used to have. I think it's still a lonely job. And I think the idea of sentencing, you know, well, you know, you have a very stressful job. Lawyers in private practice have very stressful jobs, but it's this kind of difference between private practice. When you're in private practice, someone's always nipping at your heels. The IRS, your accountant, your spouse, your clients, judges. And so you're never away from your work. When you have this job, You know, you can leave the courthouse and you're not thinking about it until, you know, it comes to you that, well, tomorrow morning I have to go put I have to go sentence someone. So I think I've changed in that I'm not as social as I was. I don't have as many friends as I used to. Maybe I'm too sensitive about what others think of me. I got to get that out of my head. On the other hand, if I don't work hard, I want to always have the reputation of working hard and at least trying, even if people don't agree with me. So my insecurities are probably greater, and I'm not as social. I think that's how I've changed. Yeah.
In your career, what's the biggest courtroom surprise you ever had?
Biggest courtroom surprise. Boy, I don't know. I don't know.
Okay.
I just don't know.
I want to read you one other thing.
Yeah.
This morning, or I mean yesterday, I was in the cemetery teaching one of my great nephews how to drive a stick shift car. And we were driving down, and all of a sudden, there was a brand new bench that said Pratt on it. So I stopped, and I looked, I said to my nephew, wait a minute, stop here, and I got it. And on this bench, says Pratt, has your name, your wife's name, but there's an engraving on it. It says, do justice, love mercy, walk humbly with God.
Yes.
Is that the philosophy? Is that Bob and Rosemary's Pratt's philosophy?
Yeah, we try. Yeah.
Why'd you do that?
I don't know, because we decided that, you know, none of our kids are in town, and we thought, well, when they come home, we got to have a place for them to sit down.
I mean,
I'm serious.
It's not a tombstone waiting for you to
die.
Well, it's a bench. It's just a beautiful black granite bench.
And it's kind of, you know, I mean, I've been up and down with religion my whole life. You know, I don't know, and you know, the kind of religion that I think I grew up with was the idea that you could make a difference, and you know, so to the extent that one thinks that they make any difference in the world, you know, I have law clerks. I said, well, what do you want to do? Well, I want to change the world. Oh, I said, well, I wanted to do that once. I gave up on that. So yeah, I think that is our philosophy, that we try to do the right thing.
Then let's end it on that. Do justice, love mercy, walk humbly with God.
Yeah.
Thanks, Judge.
Thank you, Michael.